Our next guest is known by fans around the world for the great battle he had with Jose Aldo and the amazing career he had inside the cage. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to say that Mark Hominick is on Submission Radio. Mark, welcome to the show.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's our pleasure to have you on the show, Mark. Now, you know, like Dennis said, you obviously had that amazing fight with Jose Aldo. Before we get into it, we want to talk about your career. You know, it's been a couple of years since you retired. Tell us, what have you been up to, and what have you been dedicating your time to now that your retirement, you know, from MMA has kicked in?
Well, first and foremost, it's my family. I have two little girls, so that's been my, you know, my main focus. But aside from that, you know, I'm still heavily involved in the sport. I run a gym, Adrenaline Training Center. So I coach, I teach, you know, I'm around the sport all day and every day. And, you know, this is my passion and this is what drives me every day. So definitely heavily involved. The only thing that's really changed is I'm not competing. I'm still in the gym helping guys prepare, train, coach. But, you know, I'm definitely on that side of the role now.
Absolutely, Mark. You know, we want to have a chat about what you're doing now. Before we get into that, we just want to go back in time just a little bit. Fans that are casual just got into the sport recently, you may not remember, but you were actually a part of a pretty interesting UFC card back in the day. It was called UFC 58, which was USA versus Canada, where you beat Yves Edwards in the second round with the arm triangle. Also had GSP versus BJ Penn in the card. Just looking back on that event, Mark, what was it like being a part of the UFC back then, especially because the concept was very interesting for the card?
Yeah, I was lucky to get on the card. At that point, I think I was a 7- or 8-time Canadian champion. So at the time, my manager was thinking, if they're having a UFC versus Canada card, there's no way that I couldn't be on that, you know, because I defended the title so many times. But at that point, they didn't have featherweight. So I was the featherweight champion, 145 pounds here in Canada since 2002 at that point. So it had been 4 years. So I had to go up in weight class, but I definitely jumped at that opportunity, you know, to fight the number one ranked guy at a weight class ahead. And, you know, luckily enough, I came out with a victory. So that was a huge opportunity. And that was, you know, my first step, you know, on the big stage.
And just to clarify, Mark, obviously we didn't see you in the UFC or back in the UFC for another few years. Was that because they didn't have a featherweight division at the time?
Yeah, like I thought I was going to be the world champion at 145 pounds. And to me, I that's what I wanted to be. I wanted to fight the best at my weight class. And at that point, the UFC didn't have that. My teammate, Sam Stout, was he made his debut also on that card, UFC 58, and he was fighting a lightweight. So we've always fought in separate divisions. So I felt that was his to take over. And in mine, I thought, you know, I compete against the best at 145, and that was outside of the UFC.
Back then, did you have a conversation with Dana, or did your manager have a conversation with Dana and ask him, well, how long will it take to have a, you know, featherweight division in the UFC? Or was it something that the UFC wasn't even thinking about back in those days?
At that point, that was the first time they had introduced the 155-pound, belt back. So, you knew it was going to eventually happen, but, you know, things in step, because I'm sure guys, when they brought the 145 division over to the UFC, the guys who are fighting, say, at 135 or 125 were waiting for their opportunity. So, you know, it's progression, and now the women are coming in, and now they're bringing multiple weight classes in the women. So it just takes time for divisions to develop. And I knew eventually, you know, if you're going to be fighting the best in the world, it has to be in the UFC. And, you know, I knew that weight class would eventually get there. So I just had to wait my opportunity, and it eventually came.
Yeah, you know, it seems like the sport is evolving every year. I mean, like, there's heaps to talk about, obviously, the Reebok deal, the weight classes. But back when you started in 2002, you know, it was a different time. I'm curious, what was it that drew you into MMA as a career?
Pardon me, what was my...
Like, what drew you into MMA as a career?
Oh, I definitely found my passion when I was 13 years old. My high school gym class went for an orientation class, and at a local martial arts studio, and then I signed up that night, and within 2 weeks I was competing. So I definitely found what was my passion in life, and it was in martial arts, and I never looked back from that day. I never took a day off training, and I just really started competing in kickboxing and grappling and mixed martial arts until, you know, I could fight pro at 18. So I never strayed from that goal of being a fighter, and that's what drew me, or, you know, drove me every day.
Exactly, Mark. You know, and you've got a bit of a background in a lot of the traditional martial arts. You were a karate champion, I believe, at one point, weren't you?
Yeah, like I basically competed in most martial arts coming up. Like, I competing in jiu-jitsu tournaments, in you know, like point karate tournaments in Pancration. That was where when I, you know, my introduction into, I guess, some watered down for a form of mixed martial arts, because it was you could do everything. You could strike, you could grapple, you could wrestle. There's just no strikes to the face. So it was definitely a good introduction. So I was competing even at 14 years old in mixed martial arts.
Now, even though you were not in the UFC for a number of years after UFC 58, you were busy making a big name for yourself, obviously in WEC and other promotions. It was interesting because when you did finally come back in the UFC, you fought for the title pretty quickly. You know, what was it like being back in the UFC? And, you know, tell us about that big win over George Roop that led to that fight against Jose Aldo.
Well, there's something special to say being a part of a UFC card. And, you know, it was obviously great to – it was a pretty cool experience to fight on the Affliction card with Fedor and, you know, all the WC cards. There's something memorable, but, I mean, there's something different. There's a different atmosphere when you're involved in a UFC show, and that's where every fighter wants to be. You know, you can people can say that they want to fight all over the world or whatnot, but, I mean, the big stage and where you want to compete is in the UFC, and there's something to be said about being on a card like that. The fight with George Roop, it was tough to take that fight because George and I had trained together for 3 years at that point, but I knew that was a fight that was going to lead me to a title shot, so we had to, you know, put our friendship aside and settle it in the ring. You know, I was pretty confident going into that fight, but you know, I definitely wanted to make a statement because if you're going to go in and challenge the belt, you want to have the champion, you know, concerned about what you bring to the table. And, you know, if I'd have went out there and, you know, snuck out a 3-round decision, you know, it's not as powerful statement as going out there and knocking a guy out in a minute. And that's what I did in that fight. And that's what I intended to do, is to go and make a statement.
And you mentioned Affliction there. You know, they're a company that's almost like a bit of a myth because they had so few shows. They were there, they made a big statement, and then all of a sudden they were gone. And obviously you went to the UFC right afterwards. What was the difference like being in Affliction versus the UFC? Like, what was the backstage like? What was the sort of, you know, feeling of being in Affliction like?
Well, there's definitely, like, you knew you're a part of something special. What, you know, all the fighters they had, you know, like that was at the time when Fedor was at his highest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was the myth and the mystique about him, and I'd be first to say that he did have that. Like, when he walked in the room, there's just something about him that, you know, that you were drawn to, and you know, you questioned it or whatever it was. And then when he came out, you know, I just remember the walk when he walked to the cage, because I had already fought and I was in the crowd at that point, and you know, it was almost like everyone just went silent. Like, when he walked past you, he's intimidating in his own way.
Yeah, when people talk about superheroes and compare them to MMA fighters, I definitely think Fedor would be the Batman of MMA. A lot of enigma and mystique around the guy. Now, Mark, going back to 2011, you know, like Casper said, you find yourself in the UFC. You have one tough fight before you get a title shot against Jose Aldo. What did you think about Jose before you fought him? What were your thoughts about him before you matched up with him? Did you think that this guy is pound for pound one of the best fighters in the world? Did you think that you had a good chance of beating him?
I knew he was up there for pound for pound, but I think my style was going to present problems with him, because the guy, if you go in with one game plan to just take him down and grind him out, it's not going to happen. He's got too many tools, and you have to be willing and able to kind of go through hell to get into those later rounds and go and get into a war with him, because he's so explosive where it's not going to end quick, you know, or like on your end. Like, you have to drag him into the deep waters. And I knew my striking was good enough to compete with him, because that's where he does a lot of his damages, in his leg kicks and in the striking. And just with my kickboxing background, I knew that I could hang with him, and I knew my conditioning and my speed you know, would be able to get him into deep waters, where I did. And, you know, like, I mean, I felt I had the opportunity to put him away at the end, but, you know, it wasn't in the cards that night. But it was pretty amazing to see. You know, went 5 rounds with one of the best.
Absolutely. I mean, the fight was an absolute classic. I mean, there's so many iconic moments. There's the that you had that huge hematoma on your head. What was going through your mind, you know, during those moments in the fight where it looked like you may get him, and especially, you know, it was right towards the end of the fight?
Yeah, I felt in the last round it was one of those things where you're fighting against the clock. You know, I remember looking up and it almost like the clock was going faster than it should have been. You know, I was chasing after time, but that's just the way it is. Like, I had 5 rounds to put him away, and I ran out of time to do it in the end. But it was something special, but just because for that fight, it was 15 years in the making for me of training, competing, and then finally getting to fight. And it was the biggest UFC of all time, 55,000 people, and the show was an hour away from my hometown in the first show in Ontario. So there's a lot of firsts, and just to be a part of that card, let alone, you know, come home with the fight of the night and people having, you know, the memorable fight that it was. It was something that, you know, I always cherished in my career, and that was definitely like the pinnacle of it.
You know, Jose's fought a lot of people since, and, you know, he was being pretty dominant against most of them, some close fights, but there haven't really been those moments lately like he had with him where it kind of looked like, you know, the other person might win. You know, do you think people are approaching him the wrong way? Do you think they're trying to grind it out and not really trying to finish Jose? Do you think that they need to approach the fight with Jose in a different way like you did?
Yeah, I think you have to get in his face. I don't think there's any – you can't let him dictate the pace or how the fight's going. And that's what Jose's good at, is dragging you into the fight that he wants and putting at the pace, where I felt I put a lot of pressure on him, and it wasn't like I was just diving for a takedown. I was putting pressure and striking at him and just keeping that constant, you know, attrition on him. And I think that's what you have to do, is you have to be willing to go through that battle to get him into the late rounds. But he's just so explosive where he can finish it in the blink of an eye. And I think that's what we've seen, like in the Chad Mendes fight. You could have the momentum, and then he, with one strike, one knee, one kick, he can change the momentum right there, because he can do so much damage in one shot.
And it wasn't too long afterwards that you decided to retire. I believe it was around December 2012. Just going back there, you know, how difficult was it for you to retire? And, you know, what were the main sort of things going through your head and the main, you know, reasons why you decided to retire?
I think the main reason why it wasn't that hard of a decision, which told me that it was the right one, where I didn't have to go back and forth. I knew it was my time, because at that point I had competed professionally since 2002. Mm. So it was, you know, over a decade of competing. I'd fought for the world title, and I felt I put on the best performance. And I, you know, like all those years to that moment. And then after that fight, I had three losses against guys, in my opinion, I should beat in the first round. And there's a lot of things that happened. Like 2 weeks after I fought for the belt, I had my first daughter. And then 2 months after that, I lost my coach from my whole career, Sean Tompkins. Yeah. And then I had another daughter. And you know, like life was changing. And I thought, you know, I was happy with what I'd done in my career. And I'm focused and I have heavy energy and then desire to carry on the next part of my career, which is coaching, which is running the gym. I'm still going to be involved in the sport, but I felt that, you know, it was the time to take a different role.
Now, a lot of fighters have long-lasting injuries after retirement, like Bas Rutten, for example, that comes to mind. We're just wondering, how is your body feeling, and how do you feel physically, you know, since retirement? Do you feel fine, or are there any lingering injuries from MMA?
I definitely have a lot of injuries, like chronic stuff with my shoulders. But I feel, in general, I'm a little healthier now, because I'm not, you know, training twice a day with sparring and whatnot. Like, I still train every day, but it's different. Like, I'm not sparring 2-3 times a week, and I'm healthier in that way. But yeah, like, I didn't retire because my body was giving out or anything like that. I just felt that, you know, I could compete, but again, I was competing at a level that I expect more of myself, you know, because I think there's other demands, you know, with a family and, you know, just focus on that. So I didn't have the same mindset as what I had when I was competing. And again, I'm not just competing to get in there and fight. I'm getting there to be the world champion and to beat the best in the world. And like I said, I've lost to three guys that I feel that I should beat in the first round. So I think that was a big indicator that, it was my time to walk away.
And I think it happens to a lot of guys. You feel like, you know, one day they're the best, or one day they're on top, and the next, you know, they lose certain fights, and sometimes guys, you know, hang around for you know, years and years. Do you feel like MMA is one of those sports where it's very hard to have a happy ending, and a lot of guys usually don't go out on their own terms?
No question. I think in any sport, because you're driven by your passion and your will to fight, and like I said, I've had plenty of times in my career where I've had ups and downs. Like, that's just the nature of the sport, where you've had losses and you have to kind of climb back and get back on the horse and get back on the winning track. So I had a lot of those, you know, like I had a couple losses in WC, and then I had to kind of redefine myself, and I came back and then won 3 years straight. Like, I didn't have a loss within 3 years, and then I fought Aldo for the belt. So there's always those things in in your career, and it is hard to walk away, because if you're winning and you're at the top of the sport, there's no reason to walk away. And yeah, it's a tough decision, but again, like, I don't feel I'm walking away from the sport, just from the competition end of it.
Mm. Now, Mark, you know, it seems like you've had a very successful retirement. Like you mentioned, you've got the wonderful family, you've got the great gym, you're still a part of the sport, but retirement in general from MMA, do you think it's difficult for a lot of these athletes? Do you think there needs to be something like a pension fund? Because a lot of them don't have the same thing that you do. A lot of them don't have a great family or a business to sound of bands back down on once they retire. Do you think that's an issue in MMA?
It is. Like, I mean, it is a new sport, though. That's the thing. Like, realistically, it's been in the mainstream since, you know, like, since the 2000s. Like, you know, the first UFC was 93, but again, that was a different sport, different landscape, where, you know, like, when, I guess, the after the Ultimate Fighter, you know, that you're looking at, like, 2005. So that's really when the sport is taken off. So that, you think how old the other sport, like hockey or baseball or soccer or whatever the other sport, how long they've been around and how much guidance they've had and they've learned through experience. And I think we're going to look back in 10 years and we're going to learn from what, you know, how we went through and how we dealt with it. But a pension thing, it's hard to, it's a lot more difficult situation or to manage than you think, right? If you look at other sports like boxing, like where it's an individual sport, there's no pension that as well. So I think the athletes just have to be surrounded by good mentors, good management. So I think it's a lot on you to take ownership of it.
Now, Mark, we're literally a few days away now from it being, I believe, officially 2 years since you retired in 2012. I'm just curious, do you at all feel the itch to come back at any point in time?
You know what? Like, I'm still training. Like, there's obviously some days, like, you know, when I'm in there sparring with guys and, you know, I feel as ready as ever. But, you know, like I said, I would never be one of those guys who's half in the pool or half out. Like, I'm either in or out. And, you know, I'm kind of like 100% type person where it's 100% in or 100% out. So, like, definitely I love training. I love being a part of the sport. But, you know, I'm happy with what I've done in my fighting career. And now, like, I'm focused on the next phase.
You know, the featherweight division in the UFC, it's funny, you know, back when you fought at UFC 58, it was non-existent. Now it's one of the hottest divisions out of all the divisions in the UFC. What's your thoughts on the landscape of the featherweight division now compared to even, you know, back when you were fighting in the featherweight division? What do you think about some of these, you know, young athletes that are making a name for himself in the division?
Well, I think Conor McGregor has completely flipped the division upside down, and that's exactly what it needed. You know, like, you can see the pay-per-view numbers, the draw, it's not the same for the 125, the 135, and the 145 division. So you need someone with that it factor that brings eyes and butts to the seat. And that's what Conor's doing. And I think if he was in another division, that division would get that same spike. So I think that's why everyone's talking about it. And with that being said, I think it helps gather the respect that Aldo deserves, because, you know, a lot of, same as like Mighty Mouse, like I think he's one of the best pound for pound fighters, and no one even gives him the respect because there's no attention for it. And what Conor's done for the 145 division not only obviously brings attention to him, but it also brings attention to Jose Aldo, the champion, and to see what, you know, how long his winning streak is and how good he is. So I think it's good for the whole division, not just Conor.
Absolutely. And do you think that maybe, say, the flyweight division would benefit from another, you know, say, a flyweight like Conor McGregor?
They need it. Like, I mean, it's like anything. Like, it doesn't matter what division is. Like, you know, like, just like boxing, like, it's Floyd Mayweather or Manny Pacquiao. It's because of that person that the attention's on that division. It's because, you know, it's that, you know, long ago, like, for boxing, like, the heavyweight, you just went for the heavyweight or tight, whoever it was. But now it's a guy, and you need that person that brings attention to a division, in any division would you know, gather more interest about having a guy like that.
You know, Conor McGregor, he gets a lot of flack. You know, people always say, oh, the UFC matchup with guys that he could beat. What are your thoughts on the kid as a fighter? Do you think he'd have a shot against a guy like a Jose Aldo? Let's say he gets matched up with him later on this year. Do you think he could beat a guy like him?
On paper, you can't say that. There's no way you can say that he can hang with Jose Aldo. He's never fought anybody in the top 10. So, I mean, there's no, I guess with Dustin Poirier, he's in the top 10, but you know, he's had one fight against a guy in the top 10. So to say that he's ready to take a shot at that title, on paper, no, but for the attention that he's gathered for the division, I think he's earned it, and I think that's what you have to do. And like I said, with his like when I fought Roop, you have to go out and make statements, whether it's with your fight or whether it's with your mouth, but people want to see him fight. So I think he deserves the respect to take that shot. I know there's guys in line, like Frankie Edgar deserves that shot more than anybody. But, you know, Conor's definitely got the attention that people are interested in that fight.
And I'm not sure how much MMA you watch nowadays and how many UFC shows, but I'm just curious, if you do, do you ever find yourself watching the featherweight division and the fights and sort of sizing the guys up or breaking them down in terms of, like, skill levels?
I'm a fan of the sport, and it doesn't really matter what division. But I thought that Frank Yeager fight was something else. I was always a fan, but you know, I'm a massive fan. That was something else. It was pretty incredible, the tenacity he has, and I think every young fighter should look at a guy like Frank Yeager and pick him as a role model.
Now, the big thing that got announced by the UFC is their partnership with Reebok. You know, you're a gym owner now, and there's a lot of, you know, up-and-coming fighters coming out of your gym. What do you think about this move that the UFC made? Do you think it's good that fighters are going to have the uniforms and lose the individual sponsorships?
I think the sport's going to benefit because, you know, just like if the UFC is trying to make it, to be accepted like NFL or Major League Baseball or the NHL or professional hockey, you know, I think having that uniform look, you know, creates, you know, consistency within the brand. So I think it's good in that end. Obviously, you know, if someone had a great sponsor that was always loyal and backing them, it's going to hurt them in that way. And also the managers, you know, like I was lucky enough to have a great manager in Robert Rivetta. And I gave him a call because I think, you know, the first and foremost, the people are going to get hurt is the managers first off. But I know a couple fighters in our gym that fight with the UFC and they were thrilled to hear about the partnership and they're looking forward to it. So I time will tell. And I hope, you know, the fighters at the end of the day, benefit from it.
I think the biggest sort of aim for the UFC to try and get this, I mean, there's a lot of goals here, but one of them they're saying is to sort of eliminate the need to go out and search and grab those sponsors. Can you tell us a little bit about what the process was like for getting a sponsor? And did you have any of those bad experiences that people often talk about?
I think early in my early days, because, you know, like the sport was evolving and, you learn too that the real people were in the sport. But I think, that, like I said, surrounding yourself with a good manager and good mentorship is what you need. And the last thing I think a pro fighter should be worrying about is him having to knock down doors and ask for someone to sponsor them. That's a manager's job. And I think, you know, the fighters have to take that seriously and make sure that they make a partnership, you know, with their manager and that's the way it should be. It should be a two-way street, and, you know, the fighter's focus should be training and stepping in the cage and performing.
Really good analysis there, Mark. Now, we let the fans know you're coming on the show. We've got a few fan questions for you. First one's from Raging Rick. Raging Rick would like to know your thoughts on training. He goes, fighters getting injured is a big part of the sport these days. How have you modified the training in your gym to make sure, you know, your fighters aren't getting as injured, and is sparring as much of a part of training as it was back when you first started?
Yeah, that's a good question. And like I said, this is a relatively new sport when you break down the years that, you know, that we've been competing at this level. So yeah, exactly. You learn as the years go by. You learn from other camps. You learn from other coaches. And I think that's one thing is having a good coaching staff that monitors, you know, the training and sets guidelines and sets the precedent of what a training camp is, what you do on each day. And the second question with the sparring, I remember when I was starting in like 2002, I'd be sparring four times a week, you know, and obviously that's not good. That's way too much. Injuries happen. I think we're down in our camp. We're 1 to 2 days a week sparring now. I mean, the guys normally spar on Tuesdays and Saturdays, and a lot of times the guys will either pick one or the other, so it's down to even 1 week of hard sparring. I think, you know, you have to be fight ready, so yeah, the conditioning training is definitely, I think, the biggest part. But, you know, sparring is a massive part of your training, but I think it's not as often as when I started.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of gym owners and coaches are going towards that sort of route. Now, I've got a question for MMA Mark. MMA Mark wants to know, you were one of the best strikers in the featherweight division. He wants to know, how would you have matched up against Conor McGregor?
I think my speed, I think he blitzes guys with his speed, and I think I'm faster than him. But again, like, I'm not, I mean, I'm in no spot to be calling, you know, making shots at guys when I can't come back and back it up by fighting. But, you know, I think I match up really well with him, but I think he's got a really unique style. I think he's fearless. I think it'd make for an exciting fight. But I think one thing that, you know, I would give him problems with is my speed.
Now, Mark, we've got a segment here we like to call the Submission Ready a Tap Out round. It's a fun round where we give you some fun questions and you answer with the first thing that comes to your mind. Are you ready?
You bet.
What's Christmas look like in the Hominick household?
Lots of Christmas trees. I think we have 3 Christmas trees. I have 2 little girls, so lots of decorations.
Now, we noticed you were selected for the great honor of jury duty. We have to ask, what was it like and how many times did you inappropriately yell, "I object"?
Yeah, I think luckily I didn't get picked. I got some tips from other people to not get selected.
You'll have to tell us after the show.
What's your favorite fight outside the UFC that listeners that are listening right now may not have seen and need to YouTube immediately?
Well, we have a top 125 pounder in our gym, Malcolm Gordon. He was ranked number 1 in Canada at the flyweight division. He's a finisher. He had all his wins by finish.
Sorry, Mark. And I also meant, what's one of your fights outside the UFC that the listeners can watch on YouTube immediately that's been outside the UFC? So when you fought for like the WEC or one of the other promotions, one of your favorites?
I think the Yves Jabouin fight, myself versus Yves Jabouin at WC 49. I think in that year it was voted round of the year. I think we had over like 400 strikes in 2 rounds. So it was a war.
Awesome. Now, in the early days coming up in the sport, did you ever have any strange experiences or moments where you were like, yeah, this is definitely the minor leagues?
Oh, I've fought in some smoky bars in Iowa and Indiana. And yeah, definitely, you know, looking around, making sure that we got out of there safe after we got our wins.
Yeah.
Who was your idol in MMA, Mark?
I really, coming up as a fighter, I really liked Wanderlei Silva. I just liked his tenacity, his aggression. And my first fight in 2002, I wore his fighting shorts and kind of to pay respect to him.
Now, during day-to-day activities, do you still whip out the push-ups when you beat somebody?
Yeah, I'm always in the gym. And I'm a competitive person, so that's part of my repertoire.
So, for example, you take a car spot away from someone, you're getting out of that car and you're doing those push-ups, right?
Yeah, a little bit.
Now, is there anybody that can beat Jose Aldo, in your opinion?
I think Frankie. I mean, he's already beat Frankie, but I think just his that last fight was something special, the performance he put on, and I'd love to see that fight.
Now, you mentioned the Yves Jabouin fight, but I'm wondering if there's any others. What was your favorite fight of your entire career?
I don't know if it's the favorite fight, but like one that still, you know, still gets me riled up is a Hatsu Hioki. We fought twice in our last fight. We went 5 rounds. It was for the TKO title. And I lost a split decision where I thought I won, but he's one of those guys that I'd fight him in my backyard if I had another opportunity.
Damn it, Hatsu. And finally, what's one thing that you want people to remember about you when they look back on your career, which is, you know, very, very impressive?
I think just the way I approached it, like I took everything serious, you know, and I was as serious inside the cage as outside the cage. And I think that's what, you know, athletes need to do.
Guys, don't forget to follow Mark on Twitter, obviously, at Mark Hominick. And, of course, check out his website, markhominick.com. And, of course, check out your gym. Mark, where can people find your gym?
www.adrenalinemma.ca. So it's Adrenaline Training Center. So that's our gym.
Awesome.
And it's one of the best ones around, guys. So if you're traveling down to Canada, no brainer, get down there and see if you can at push up Mark.
My cousin's from Sydney, so he's been down at the gym as well. So we've brought your country here.
Oh, very nice. Well, Mark, we just want to say thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been a great pleasure. You're welcome anytime. And thank you so much for taking the time.
Hey, both ways. Great talking to you guys.